Now, the angel couldn't come today, so I did. And it's to tell you in the midst of your storm, on your way to Caesar, don't be afraid. I'm not an idiot. I see the storm. You're going to lose the ship, but nobody's going to die. You haven't fulfilled your destiny yet. And it's good to know that if what God has promised you and if what God has spoken over your life hasn't been fulfilled, it must be fulfilled. And I don't care if it's a dinosaur or finances or the doctor said incurable cancer, you don't have to be afraid. Everybody can count you out, but all God has to say is you are going to Caesar. Now, don't get caught up. I ain't going over to Caesar in Rome, but I'm headed to my vision. I'm headed to my destiny. On your way in the will of God, doing what he told you to do, he said, no life shall be lost. Nothing, not even the devil, will be able to seize you. That's a good promise. The storm may have altered your course. You may even have lost the ship. But God has not forgotten what he promised. All right? Now, you can't be in agreement with that if you've given up. See, you can't be in agreement with God if you've lost hope. David said, why art thou cast down, O my soul? Put your hope in God. Paul, you got to get to Caesar. And on your way to Caesar, if you'll stay in the boat, no one can seize you. Now, that's a good promise for moms and dads in here. You got trouble with your kids. Maybe you've even lost one of the children for all practical purposes. God says, if you'll stay true to the call of God, if you'll stay true to the vision, and you'll do what is right, God said, don't worry. Everybody with you will be saved. There'll be no loss of life. So don't let your soul get cast down. Don't change anything. That's right. All of those who sail with you will be delivered. Take hold of that promise and believe your whole family will be saved. If I'm obedient as a leader to the call of God, then every member that God placed in our church, every team member that God put on our staff, I'm not talking about hirelings and people that just drift through because they like the music, but God sent, God planted people. If I'm on the will of God, you aren't going to perish. There'll be no lost destinies. There will be no lost marriages, no lost lives if you will stay in that ship. And I've watched men in the middle of a storm break relationships, jump ship, and lose destiny. Don't do it. Don't do it. He says, stay right where you are. Be of good courage. Verse 25. Now, how do you get good courage? You encourage yourself. I thank God for encouragers. You ever needed one? Man, it's nothing like it. It's a breath of fresh air. But what do you do when there aren't any? You gotta encourage yourself. It says David encouraged himself in the Lord. There wasn't anybody to help him. Even the staff was thinking about stoning him. They had lost the city, their wives, their cars, their certificates of deposit at the bank. Everything had been stolen. And they're gonna kill David. And David didn't have anybody to say, well, David, bless God, you're a man of destiny and vision. He's alone in a cave, running, thought he's gonna get killed, and it says he had to encourage himself by himself. Maybe I could put it this way. Well, I'll show you in a minute. You got to force feed yourself. Look at the second part. He says, for I believe God that shall be even as it was told me. See, now what did God say to Paul? Verse 29:31. I'm still not where we're going. I'm just getting there faster. Let's see. Where are we now? About verse 29 through 31. Then fearing lest we should have fallen upon rocks, they cast four anchors out of the stern and wished for the day. And as the crew, some of the crew, were secretly about to escape out of the ship, leave the church, break out of the marriage, when they had let down the boat to the sea, under pretense they're going to cast anchors out. Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, except these stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. Then the soldiers cut off the excuses for leaving church, cut off the ropes of the boat, and let her fall off. I hope you get this. He said, all that sail with you shall be saved, but they got to stay in the ship. And when people get in trouble, when storms arise, people like to slip sort of back to the back of the ship, watch people start moving to the back, and then when nobody's looking, they jump ship, they go over the side. And these old boys in the middle of the storm, in the middle of the confusion, are secretly about to jump ship. And Paul said, hold it! Cut those ropes off or they can't be saved. And that means cutting away the excuses of why they should quit. Getting rid of those excuses. I'm going to tell you something. Sometimes you can't do it by yourself. Sometimes you got to have some friends help you cut the ropes. I've had friends many times help me cut the ropes. I'd have drowned. Now look in verse 33. It says, "And while the day was coming on, Paul besought all of them to take food, saying, 'This day is the 14th day you have fasted.'" Can I take the religion out of this? They're seasick. This ain't no fast as holy unto God. They have... Anybody ever been seasick? And just puke your guts out? I mean, somebody said, "Food? You must be crazy. Food. Oh, then you're sick again." Anybody even says it? These guys haven't eaten in 14 days. They cannot eat. Now, he says, "I pray you take some food, for this is for your health. For there shall not a hair fall from the head of any of you." Sorry, Brian. Sometimes God makes exceptions, but in the vernacular of the day, it meant they weren't going to die, not lose any hair. But that was a little hyperbole. Now, verse 35, he says, "And when he had thus spoken, he took bread, gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. And they all became encouraged, and they all were of good cheer. And they also took some food." So he says, take food so you'll have some strength. And then verse 35, I think we've already gone over that. Verse 37, there's about 276 people all together in the boat. Now, folks, put your Bible down for a second. Storms are a fact of life. John 16, verse 33 says, "In this world, you will have tribulation. You will have persecution." Jesus said for it. So A, look for it. B, expect it. C, it's coming. That's not a faithless statement. That is a point of fact. It is a statement to exhort you to prepare. In the Boy Scouts, when I was a kid, we had a motto, be prepared. And we ought to have a statement in the church, be prepared. Why? Storms are a fact of life. But in the midst of the storms, be of good cheer. He says, "For I've overcome the world." Now, Peter confirms this in 1 Peter 4, verse 12 and 13. I'm reading out of the Amplified. "Beloved, do not be amazed and bewildered at the fiery ordeal which is taking place to test your quality, as though something strange, unusual, and alien has befallen you." How many times do you get in a storm and say, with me, "Why is this happening?" But insofar as you are sharing Christ's suffering, rejoice. May I say, you make a choice to rejoice. It's not a feeling. You make a choice to rejoice, so that when his glory, full of radiance and splendor, is revealed, you may rejoice with triumph. So what are we learning? We're learning that storms, and it doesn't matter whether God sent it, the devil sent it, or you brought it. I have been in some storms I generated, created all by myself. Have you ever had one of those? And it doesn't matter. God will still use it the same way. So don't panic over that. But we're learning that they come to test our quality, the quality of our character, our zeal, our courage, our enthusiasm, our passion. How committed am I? Your mouth won't tell me anything. One good typhoon will tell me everything. For me too. How about you? Yeah. How committed am I? Test it. All right? And the most serious consequence of any storm is to lose hope. Taking on the spirit of hopelessness. And people take that spirit when they lose hope. Now, we call its manifestation depression, the blues, lack of joy, lack of expectation, and you're just blah. Do you say that in Australia? We got the blahs. Somebody, "Yea, the Lord would say unto you," and you'd say, "Yeah, sure. Come on." I think you need to know, discouragement happens to super saints. It happens to those in the faith camp. It happens to everybody. I'm almost getting to where I want to go. Would you just hold your place and maybe look with me in Job? Go to Psalms and turn left. Job chapter 3. This will help you on your dark day. God said, this is the best man in the earth. So let's look into the life of the best man in the earth. "My servant, devil, have you seen anything like him?" Verse 1, chapter 3. Oh, you must read this. please. This will be good for a laugh. After this, circle this and just write storm. Job opened his mouth and cursed the day he was born. And Job, the best man in the world, spoke and said, "Let the day perish, I was born." And the night in which somebody said, "A male child has been conceived." Let that day be darkness. Let not God regard it from above, neither let the light shine on it. Verse 11, why didn't I miscarry? Why did I not give up the ghost when I came out of the belly? I reckon you could say he is depressed. This is a bad hair day. Please, in my dark hour, sometimes I just read that and think, maybe I got a chance. Elijah, the great prophet of God, in the midst of fear from Jezebel and despair, said, "Take my life, just kill me." Have you ever prayed one of those prayers? No, you haven't. I have. Have you ever just wished to die? Moses goes up on the fiery mountain to meet with God and get God's law. While he's up there, the church elects a new pastor. They get a new doctrine, the golden calf. And how many of you know that'll depress a preacher? And not only that, they're having an orgy. And Moses became so depressed and so discouraged, he broke all 10 commandments at once. Bam! Right? All right. And maybe some of you have cried out like Elijah, "Lord God, take my life." I've made two discoveries. One, I'm glad God doesn't answer all my prayers. Number two, if you want to have a pity party, the devil will always go halves with you. Always go halves with you. This will be good for you too. In John 14, these are the disciples, the mighty apostles. And they've got Jesus as their shepherd. How many of you think, boy, I could do a lot better if I had the Lord God Almighty as my shepherd. I could really walk with him. I mean, come on, be honest. You'd think so, right? Well, here are these guys, and they're with Jesus. And Jesus says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled." They had Jesus himself as their pastor, and they still got emotional trouble. Folks, it's going to be okay. I'm trying to let you know they're all in the same fix. This is common to everybody. Now, don't ask why. God never answers that. I've tried, so just don't. He says his thoughts are past finding out, above my thoughts. Just know most folks do get depressed. I heard about a man and a policeman. And a man pulled up to the stop sign. He slowed down, rolled through it, and didn't stop. The policeman saw him, went and pulled him over and said, "Excuse me, sir, you failed to stop for that sign." He said, "I did not. I did stop." The police officer said, "You did not stop. You rolled through it." He said, "Well, it's the same thing." Policeman said, "It's not the same thing, and to prove it, here's a ticket." The next day, same place, the driver comes back, same stop sign, he slows down, rolls through it, and doesn't stop. The policeman pulls him over and said, "Sir, it greatly distresses me that you're failing to comprehend the message of stop. You fail to stop for that sign." He said, "I did not. I did stop." The policeman said, "You did not." The man said, "I did too." He said, "You did not, you rolled through it." He said, "It's the same thing." Policeman said, "It is not, and to prove it, here's another ticket." The third day, he's right back on the sign. And he slows down, rolls through it, and the policeman pulls him over and said, "Sir, your inability to grasp the meaning of this stop sign has greatly depressed me." And he jerked the motorist out through the window, took his nightstick, began to beat him about the head, and then said to him, "You want me to stop or just slow down?" Amen. Everybody gets discouraged. Amen. Now, one of the symptoms that usually accompanies depression and despair is hopelessness, despair. Acts 27:21 says, they had not eaten for many days. And the tragic thing, church, is that it ain't just the loss of your physical appetite, it's the loss of your spiritual appetite for spiritual bread. How many of you know when you get sick, you're not hungry? And when you're wounded and sick spiritually, you're not hungry. Now listen and know this. Ever tried to say to your kids, now you just got to eat something? And they just don't want to, and sometimes you have to force feed them. But it's the, bless you, hon. It's the loss of desire to eat spiritual food. And when we're discouraged and when we're depressed, we quit eating from the spiritual table. We quit fellowshipping. We quit going to church. We quit reading the Bible. And we often heap counselors to ourselves who are more discouraged and depressed than we are. And they weigh us down into more hopelessness. Let me give you a few major causes of depression, seven of them. Number one, extreme disappointment. Extreme disappointment will depress and discourage you. I never get discouraged when things are going well. I really don't need God. But when everything is lost, suddenly you need God. David said, before I was afflicted, I went astray. And there's nothing in the world like disappointment to cause your countenance to drop and your soul to be cast down, right? A great, great letdown. Number two, lack of self-esteem. Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself. And you can't love me if you don't like yourself, and you don't like the way you look, and you don't like the way God made you, and you don't like where you were born, you don't like your race, you don't like your mother, you don't like your father. You just despise yourself. You never give yourself any credit for anything, and it will bring depression upon you. Say with me these words, I'm special. I'm unique. I'm a child of God. I was born an original. I refuse to be a copy. I am loved by God. Nothing can defeat me. Now give somebody next to you a high five. Amen. You are. Number three, unfair comparisons. Unfair comparisons. Never, never, never compare yourself. Never, never, never. Preachers are notorious at it. It'll depress you. You'll compare gifts, you'll compare preaching, you'll compare abilities, you'll compare, and you will be destroyed. God didn't make any two of us alike. If two of us are identical, one of us isn't necessary. Hello? Scripture says if we compare ourselves among ourselves, we are foolish and not wise. Wives, don't compare yourself to another preacher's wife. Don't compare yourself to somebody else in the church. God made just what he wanted with you. Now, if you don't like that, I can't help it, but you'll be depressed forever. Don't compare. It will destroy you. Don't let ministers get into that. And no matter what you've got, what you can do, there's always somebody better. Right? Always somebody better. Don't compare. I heard about two old ladies. We say senior citizens, but two old ladies talking to each other. One had never been married, and one had been married three times, and all three of her husbands had died and been cremated, and she had all three of them in burial urns on her mantle. And the woman that was never married looked at the other woman and said, my God, here you are with husbands to burn, and I can't even find one. You know? Don't compare. Number four. A sense of being trapped. Trapped in a situation that has no visible solution. Trapped in a bad marriage. Trapped in a career going nowhere. Trapped in a location you find confining. And there's no worse feeling than to feel there's no way out. Have you ever been in a situation and you didn't feel there was any way out? I have. I know the Bible. I know God. I know the Holy Spirit. I've been around the block. And I'm telling you, you better know what brings this depression. There's always hope with God. Hope in God. There is always a way. When there is no way, he makes a way. Right? Put your hope in him. But it will depress you in that sense of being trapped. It's depressing. No joy. No peace. Just feeling trapped. Number five. Unrealistic goals. That'll frustrate you, make you strive. It'll bring depression. Never try to do anything God hasn't equipped you to do. There are ministers frustrated in ministries God never put them in. There are traveling ministries frustrated in ministries they launched and God didn't, and they're frustrated. Don't set unreasonable goals in your life.
Don't, that if you start comparing, you'll do it. Don't do that. Stay within the sphere, stay within the measure of what God made you to be, and always with good, wise counsel. Number six, biological malfunction. Now, let me tell you, this is like, here, I remember when I was in seminary, they said, boys, I'd rather burn out for God than to rust out. And, oh, man, everybody clap. I now know that was the stupidest thing he could have ever preached. You are never supposed to burn out. The Holy Ghost can't burn out. You burn out when you've got friction and no oil. When you're doing something in the flesh, not by the anointing that God didn't call you to do. And I think it's important to understand, what does the biological have to do with it? Listen, improper food, lack of rest, stress, extreme stress, and you break down the body. Now that'll produce depression. It's a lack of trust in God. It's striving. Now, how many of you know, if I'm going to go the long haul, I got to have some reasonable health. And there are a lot of sick charismatics who don't have a demon. I believe in demons, but they don't have a demon, and Benny Hinn won't help you. You eat the wrong thing. You eat a non-healthy diet, and you want healing. Now listen to this. Paul said to the best charismatic church in the Bible, they had the gift of healing, the gift of faith. They had all the gifts, miracles. And Paul says, for this cause, many are sick, weak, and have died. And now all these apostles and all these gifts, and nobody got well. Why? There wasn't a demon among them. They had bad dietary habits, and they had strife, unforgiveness, and bitterness with brothers. And there's no healing for that because it's in you. And I'm telling you, we get half the church healed if we just got rid of that. I don't want to overplay this, but I do want to tell you something. If I'm going to fulfill the will of God, then I'm looking as a vision for the future, and good health has got to be a lifestyle. Nothing fanatic, but I'm saying just good, reasonable health, dropping that extra 100 pounds or stones or kilos or whatever you say, right? Getting proper rest, taking off with your wife, going and having fun. In December of this year, I traveled 77,000 miles in 3 weeks in 5 nations. American Airlines sent me my statement, and I wrote on it with a pen, "This is a sick man." I abused my health and my emotions. And I was shattered, listen to this, physically. I did aerobics every day, stamina, no body fat, eat great, results in ministry were fantastic, but my soul was dying. I wasn't happy, I wasn't fulfilled, and when you are destroying your soul, it has to be refreshed in a secular way. Now listen, you religious fanatics, you gotta go golf or fish. Bible reading ain't what you need when that's what I'm doing. I need to go play. And I'm older, and I can't do what I did at a certain age. I have to balance that. Your tastes change, midlife crisis. I'm 51 years old, and it changed. And I don't know why, but I didn't like anybody. I didn't like my wife. I didn't like the church. I didn't like God, and I didn't care. I'm going to tell you something. I never thought that could happen to me. But it happened to me. And the problem was, my soul was being neglected. I didn't mean to. It wasn't something, I'm going to go out and neglect my soul and see how fast I can readily burn out, get into divorce, and leave the church. And thank God, I made some immediate changes. Good counsel, good friends, good, wonderful people to step in and help me, Brother Casey, Ray McCauley, Bobby, and others. And man, I just went through a time when I thought I wasn't going to make it. And there wasn't any apparent reason, but I was just overkilling myself. So I've told our staff, if it stops being fun, we ain't going to do it. And we're going to take more time off to play, take more rest, and we're going to let everybody else run and be hurry and be busy. Jesus never burned out. In the middle of a healing service, he left them, went over to a mountain, says, take and eat, we need this. He'd stop everything he's doing. He never got overtired without stopping to rest or eat. And yet we're under the delusion, if we don't take a vacation, if we work extra hard, we'll get more points with God. No, you won't. You'll end up in divorce court or dead. You will not. You got to sharpen the axe. You got to get rest, get vacations, and at any point it comes on you, take a day off. The world won't go to hell, and nobody will miss you. And the poor will still be there. The professional counselees, they'll still be there. Everything was there. It'll still be there. And if you're going to be there, never let the work of God destroy the work of God in you. Right? You husbands, take a vacation. Work on your marriage. Have some fun. Don't wait till 11 o'clock at night to make love when you're under heavy stress and busy schedules, because there ain't no way. Nothing looks good at 11 o'clock at night, heavy stress and tired. No makeup, no perfume, no desire, nothing. Come to bed with some egg-stained nightgown and say, hey, baby. That's when you have a headache, right? So I just began to take care of some things and get things fixed. So watch out for the stress and watch out for these little symptoms. Number 7, living in the prison house of regrets. There's nothing more depressing than feeling like a failure. Listen to me, nothing. If only. You can't live there. The past torments us to what was instead of what is and what could be. Paul says, forgetting those things that are behind, forget them. Don't regret them. Get rid of it. I can't undo the past, but I can prepare and change the future. Right? Learn to say, okay, I'm going to learn from that. B, I'll receive forgiveness for that. Or C, I won't ever do that one again. I've learned a good lesson here. If the mule kicks you once, it's his fault. But if he kicks you twice, it's your fault. You regret you divorced. You regret you had an abortion. You regret. You can't live there, and that's why the cross is there. To forgive you so you can go on with your life. And those regrets become anchors that hold you in the harbor. Don't do it. Don't do it. Forget them. Get up and go on. People want you to mourn forever. Don't mourn forever. If Jesus said forget it, you forget it. Amen. You're a wiser, smarter person, and it's amazing. He has less problem with our problems than we do. Who stays depressed? Those who choose to. If you believe the storm is permanent, you'll stay depressed. And instead of hearing the words of encouragement from God's word, then you're going to listen to the winds of self-pity and refuse to hear the Holy Ghost saying to you, be of good cheer. Now listen, folks, this is just practical, and I'm almost to where I want to preach. This is just the introduction. If the world in the fog of their pain, heathen, can walk into a bar and nightclub, hurting and aching with sin and condemnation and pain and hurt, and they can lift the cup of alcoholic joy and say cheers in their pain, then why can't we, as sons and daughters of the Most High God, members of the kingdom of God, in the midst of our storm, take the cup of the Holy Ghost and lift it up and say to the world, be of good cheer, cheers, 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 cheers. Amen. We can be of good cheer right in the midst of the wind. Jesus has given us 3 cheers. Matthew 9, verse 2, be of good cheer. Your sins are forgiven you. Mark 6, verse 50, be of good cheer. It's I. Be not afraid. John 16, 33, be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. Verse 21 of Acts 27 says that in the midst of the storm, they had eaten nothing for a long time. Listen, we're almost through. If you're going to emerge victorious from the storm, you're going to have supernatural strength. And to receive supernatural strength, you've got to have supernatural food. And you're only going to get that on a supernatural table. David said in the 23rd Psalm, Lord, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my storm, my enemies. Now, learn to force feed yourself in the midst of a storm on God's word. Eat bread in the midst of the storm. But let's put it this way. Force feeding a child, we know what that's like. Force feeding yourself is you're about to lose hope You don't see any visible solution. You're deeply discouraged. You're depressed. You don't know if even God loves you. You don't love you. And you bring yourself to church and you ain't feeling joyous or victorious. You ain't feeling nothing. You're just glad to be there. And they're lucky to have you. And if anybody says anything, you'll leave. You just come. It looked like it rained down here. And I have come to church myself. And I thought, if the sick and the depressed and the brokenhearted knew where I was inside of me, they'd be afraid for me to pray for them. They'd die. And I'm just sitting there, and I got no hope, and I'm not feeling good, and the praise kicks off, and prayer kicks off, and, you know, it's an amazing thing. About the end of the service, I think I'm going to make it. I feel encouraged. I feel somewhat strengthened. I force-fed myself. I didn't want to. Didn't want to pray. Didn't want to praise. Oh, everybody, let's praise the Lord. And you're in a storm, you don't want to. If I'm in my summer and you're in your winter and we meet in the hall, it ain't good. Well, brother, if you just believed God, you'd be well. Oh, that's great. You're in your summer. I'm over here getting pruned in my winter. I'm just hoping I'm going to live the day. And here he is knocking me about and criticizing me because I'm not well yet. You know what I'm saying? It depends. Churches go through seasons. People go through seasons. God cycles all of us. Hey, storm's never permanent. It's never as bad as you think. Please, I've learned this. It's never as bad as you think. You must believe that. And you must force feed yourself. So Paul, on his way to Caesar, it said everybody else gave up. He goes to prayer. He says, be of good cheer. The angel of the God said, nobody's going to perish in this thing. I'm ready for supernatural intervention. I can't help what happens to me in life in the sense of what I can't control. But I can control how I respond to what happens to me. I can control how I respond. And if you've been overwhelmed by your storm, you've cast away hope, the Holy Ghost says, be of good cheer. One quick example. Remember in 1 Kings, the little old widow and her kid, the famine, the recessions in the land, and she's gathering sticks. Now she could have just said, we're going to die. Evidently, she had been eating bread in that famine. Eating bread in the midst of her storm. And as far as she knew, here was the last two sticks, here was the last meal and the last oil, and she's going to eat this bread in the midst of a storm and die. And as she picked up the last two sticks, supernatural intervention was on the way. And I believe the Holy Ghost has authorized me to say to you, that if you'll eat bread in the midst of your storm, supernatural intervention is on the way. He can change everything in a day. He can change your heart. He can change your will. And when you didn't think there was any hope, there's no hope for your money, no hope for your finances, no hope for your marriage, no hope for your child, no hope for your ministry, it's like it's another day. Now, God knows what's going on. And he says, be of good cheer. The purpose of your life, the promises that surround it are still alive. Right? They're still alive. God hasn't forsaken you, and he hasn't forgotten you, and he won't. You've got a destiny to fulfill. You say, well, I don't know if I could ever love her. Yeah, you can. Yeah, you can. You know, God make you, if he's ugly, God can make you blind. You won't even know. Amen. He can make blind eyes open. He can shut them too. Sure again. Well, I don't know if I'll ever feel this again. Hey, feelings come, feelings go. Ask me, I'll tell you. I've been in a few. There's not many things I hadn't been able to whip, but I've been in a few places where it was rough, and I figured I didn't have any hope at all. It hadn't been for a few good friends and a few life preservers, I'd have drowned. But I did keep eating bread in the midst of my storm. I didn't want to. You know, one of the best signs to doctors when you're sick is somebody eats something. Have you ever been in a sick bed and suddenly it broke or the fever broke, found yourself getting out of bed, putting on your slippers, middle of the night, walking into the kitchen, looking in the refrigerator, and you want something to eat? You don't know what you want, but you want something. That's a good sign. And I'm telling you, in the middle of a storm, you ain't going to feel like eating. You won't feel like worshiping. You won't feel like praying. But if you'll force feed yourself and eat that bread, supernatural deliverance will come. You won't die. You won't die. Be of good cheer. On your way to Caesar, you won't die. And that good news is, supernatural intervention is on the way. Now bow your head with me. Appreciate you being so nice for so long. One of the symptoms of depression is unnatural sleeping patterns. And I want to pray for you. And I'd like to read a verse. Proverbs 3, verse 23. God says, "Then shall thy walk in the way safely, and your foot shall not stumble. When you lie down, you shall not be afraid. You shall lie down, and your sleep shall be sweet. Be not afraid of sudden fear, neither of desolation from the wicked when it comes. For the Lord shall be your confidence and will keep your foot from being taken." In December, with all of that stress and five nations in jet lag, it took me 2 months to sleep more than an hour and a half at night. It was hell. If you don't sleep, you will become unhealthy, depressed, and discouraged. It'll be an emotional drain. And you may be facing a trial financially, maritally, in a job, you're going through a storm. And God says, even in the storm, I'm going to give you sleep. And there are people who sleep too much and folks who can't sleep. In this room, how many of you suffer with insomnia or unnatural sleeping habits in which you can't sleep through a night? I wonder how many. It will shock you to know how many medically around the world have this problem. Hold your hand up real high. Incredible. I just read what God said. And I took this medicine myself and sleep like a baby. I hadn't had any jet lag problems ever since December. It has not happened again. My soul is not cast down. I ain't gonna die. I am gonna go to Caesar. I have to make some adjustments. That's good. You're gonna make some adjustments. But it's beneficial in the storm. God's gonna purge you, mature you, catapult you forward, and he's gonna heal you. And I'd like to ask those of you with those sleeping disorders, I'm gonna ask you to get up and come stand right here. And God's gonna let you sleep tonight, first time, the whole night. I'm gonna guarantee it in the name of Jesus. Get up, just get up. Come stand with me right here. That stress, that worry, that anxiety, that depression is robbing you of that rest of the Lord. And the Holy Ghost says, my gift to you is, whether you got a letter from a lawyer, a notice from a doctor, or whether your husband said, I'm going to divorce you, he said, I'm going to let you be in peace and your sleep be sweet, and the enemy will not shake you. That's good to know. He didn't say you wouldn't get the storm. He just said, I'm going to give you peace in the midst of the storm. So he says, be of good cheer. Looks bad for the moment, but it ain't near as bad as you think. And it's never what it is, it's how it ends in God. It's never where I am right now, it's how I finish. See? You can be ruffled around for a day or two, but it's how you finish. That's it. I'm waiting on everybody to come down. Just come on. Amen. Hallelujah. Lift your hands up to the Lord. Now please, you're great people. You got a great church, and I'm not teaching you anything new, but I do want you to be at peace. You can't receive if you're under stress. Be at peace. Holy Spirit, bring your presence right now. Come. Come upon your saints, your beloved, your elect. Let his sweet presence come over you. Let every chain of fear, worry, be broken. Break the power of that depression. I break the power of that torment, of fear and anxiety. I break the power of discouragement. I break the power of hopelessness. And I bind the spirit of hopelessness. Come off in Jesus' name. Off of God's people. That's right. More. I bind that spirit of insomnia. I break the power of that restlessness. Come off in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Lord, I take authority over any spirit of infirmity that's come into that body to rob them of that sleeping peace. And I pray for the power of God to give them good cheer and to cause them to lie down this night and make their sleep sweet. in the name of Jesus. Now his presence is getting stronger on somebody. Let him come. More. More. He's your hope. Cast all your care on him. He cares for you. He will not leave you. He will not forsake you. And he's going to take you to a brand new level in the storm. In the storm. Eat the bread. Stay in the relationship. Come on anyway. Having a good attitude about it's not important as it is to come. He'll fix your attitude. Come. Receive his peace right now. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Fear and sorrow and worry, go in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Go right now. I break that curse of fear. I break that curse of insomnia. Sweet peace come on this beloved in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Peace. Fear for those children. I rebuke it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Peace. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Our families will be saved. Our children and grandchildren will be saved. In the name of Jesus, worry and anxiety will go. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. I rebuke insomnia and restlessness. Priests of God, come. That's right. I command this depression and hopelessness to go. Despair, go. In Jesus' name. Fellows, that's it. Just help me. Guys, just help me. Just pray in Jesus' name. There's a wonderful anointing here. It's very strong. Take it in Jesus' name. I break this curse now. Fear, stress, hopelessness, go. God will not forsake you ever. I declare this peace on you. This day.
Jesus. You pick me up. A living hope. Of grace revealed. A life transformed. In righteousness. That you have rescued me, for giving me to heal my heart and set me free from sin and death. You brought me life, you made me whole. Oh Lord, you have rescued
me. It's going to be okay. Be of good cheer.
You love me
and you. Thank you, Lord,
you
our God is
in me for all time. The angel, your angel,
financial power.
You love me, you saw. Your blood poured out for me. Creation, your angel, Lord.
The God of all hope comforts you.
You rescued me.
being prayer. I believe there are people here, and God brought you here. Maybe a friend invited you, and you're here this morning, you've heard this. And as you heard the challenge about how to press through the storm, you need to know that God is the one that will be there for you. I believe there are people here this morning. Just look at me for a minute. Please don't tune out. Look at me. There are people here this morning, and you want to say, Steve, I want to surrender my life to Jesus. Those who have never given their life to Christ before, those this morning that you know in your heart you're away from God, and maybe you're in a storm right now. You need to know the God of peace. If that's you, what I want to do right now is just be in prayer. Let's just close our eyes, bow our heads. I'm not going to ask you to come out the front this morning. What I want you to do this morning, if you don't know Jesus, if you've never surrendered your life over to Him, if you're not a Christian or if you're away from God, right now with heads are bowed, church, I want you to be praying. If that's you, what I want you to do is raise your hands and say, Steve, that's me. There's one already. Just raise your hand and say, Steve, that's me. I want to give my life to Christ and I want to surrender over to God. Who else this morning will raise your hand and say, Steve, that's me. I want to pray for you right where you're standing. Up there in the balconies, just keep it up so I can see it. Slip up your hand. Let me pray for you right where you are. Who else this morning will raise your hands? Come on, slip it up right now. Church, pray. Let's believe that God will make Himself real to many people here this morning. There's another up there. God bless you. Who else this morning? Slip that hand up right now. That's you. Say, Steve, I want to know Jesus. I want to surrender my life over to God. Slip it up right now. Come on. Raise your hand. Say, Steve, that's me. I want to know the God of peace. I want to know the God who takes me through the storm. There's another. God bless you. Who else this morning? Amen. Hands are going up. There's another. God bless you. Who else this morning? Right at the top there. Right at the very top of the balcony. Raise your hand if that's you. Say, Steve, pray for me. I want to know Christ. I want to surrender my life over to Jesus. Who else this morning? Come on, church, pray. Who else this morning will raise your hand? Join those five or six people who've already raised their hands. Amen. Fantastic. Who else this morning, right now? Slip it up. Let me pray for you. Hallelujah. Church, let's give a lot of hand for those who've raised their hands. Come on. Raise your hand. This is what I want you to do. I want to lead you into prayer. The whole church is, we see people do this every Sunday. The whole church is going to pray a prayer. It's a prayer of accepting Christ. If you raise your hand up there, over there, through there, someone over there as well, let's say this prayer together, church. Let's say it with all our hearts. Say, Dear Lord Jesus, I come to you right now. I thank you that you died for me. I thank you that you're the God of peace. I ask you to come into my life and to make yourself real to me. And by faith in the name of Jesus, I declare that I am forgiven all my sins. I have a brand new life today. Help me to live for you, Jesus, and serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Fantastic. If you raised your hand, look at me. If you raised your hand, what I want you to do, on every exit, there'll be some people there who just have something they want to give you. On every exit, you'll see them waving up there, over there, on every exit door in the building, and they want to give you something. Look at me. If you raised your hand, I wonder if you'd do something. Would you go to them just for a minute and say, hey, I raised my hand. And they just want to talk to you just for 1 minute. They're not going to take a long time. And they just want to just encourage you on the decision you made this morning. There is something powerful about telling somebody else. Isn't there, church? How many thank God you told somebody else? Amen? So I want you to do that. Would you do that? If you raised your hand, I want you to go to the doors and they just want to give you something on your way out. God bless you.
Wonderful. Just be seated one moment. I believe there's people all over this building. The Holy Spirit really spoke to you through that message this morning. It really put encouragement in you. It just really put hope in you. It kind of made you feel, in the right sense, you know, okay about where you're at. You sort of thought, maybe there's something wrong with me. And it just really put encouragement in you. All over the place, if that's you today. Would you just lift your hand? Just keep them raised. Look at that. See, the reason I knew there'd be a lot of you is I really sensed that was a word from the Holy Spirit for a lot of people here. It's a word in season, a word in time. So receive that word and just keep living for the Lord and be a good cheer. I think that's the most important part. It's the way we respond. And that be a good cheer is a great thing. Now Rick's going to be out there at that table and where he's got his cassettes. If you want to meet him there, greet him, you can do that. It'd be great. Get a hold of some of what he's got. But can I just really ask you, and don't forget one other thing. Tonight at 6 o'clock, Rick Godwin's going to be here. And I just know he's going to speak a great word. So let's just be here and have a mighty time. We're going to have a mighty time tonight. And I want to really pray that you'll really put everything else aside. Just be here and enjoy it. Okay? We're going to take an offering for Rick Godwin. We're going to do it. This is why. Because he's invested in here. And because I really believe in sowing into the lives of those who sow into us. You can look, listen to me, you can look at a guy and say, oh, he's got that nice yellow jacket. He doesn't look to me like he needs. What someone needs is irrelevant. What we need to do is be responsive to God's word and give to those that feed us. And so that's what we give out from. And we're going to give not just a meager offering, we're going to truly bless his life and bless his ministry, bless his family, in Jesus' name. So if you're able to give, you know, everything that's given will be given to Rick and to his ministry and towards whatever it is that God's called him to do. So if you want to make out a check again, make that out to Hills Christian Life Center. But every one of these cents, everything that's given, will be signed into his life. Just get ready real quick and we'll take a love offering. Praise God. It's an honor to give to those who come a long way to feed us the way we've been fed this morning. Okay, let's get those buckets passed. Take a great love offering. Listen, that's the first service. Just pray for us this week. All of our pastoral team are going to be at our state conference. We've got 700 pastors and wives and family up there in Coffs Harbour for our state conference. You know, Hillsong, all of our team spend the whole time giving out. And so there's a conference where we go to receive, except for me, because I'm going to lead the whole thing. So pray for my voice. Pray God will really get us through and have a great time and be refreshed in Jesus' name. See you tonight. God bless you. Black Ball.